I've included a link to this video to avoid using up the time allotted by the service discussing the history of John Mung or Manjiro Nakahama and Captain Whitfield and the shogunate, the convention of Kanagawa, and the Meiji Restoration. All of what he was involved with that was of integral importance, as well as the confrontation and eventual negotiation resulting from the spotting of Commodore Perry's black ships in Edo Bay. All of that you can read about, and that's all I'll say about it. You'll notice that there's a whaling theme of harpoons and the sperm whale intertwined with the giant Noodler's catfish, and occasionally the whale ship Pequod as a theme in some of the Noodler's artwork. My great uncle was the first curator of the New Bedford Whaling Museum. His name was Reginald Hegarty. He wrote several books on the history of whaling, and as a boy, he served as a cabin boy to his own father, who was a whale ship captain, and these are remnants that were preserved by a friend of that era. This is Scrimshaw depicting a nearly stove boat. It's has been set upon Milkstone, a Schaefer desk set. The tooth is far older than the set. It's about 100 years old. This is right whale baleen. This is about 120 years old. And this is a copy of Manjiro Nakahama's hand-drawn map of his voyages circumnavigating the globe a few times in whale ships based in New Bedford and Fairhaven, Massachusetts. And this is his ink. This is his name in Japanese. This is his lifespan. This is a whaling scene that, though it's not specified by the artist, I thought it was close enough to the scene at either sunrise or sunset about the island of Torishima where Manjiro was found. This is John Mung or Manjiro Nakahama. This is Captain Whitfield. And this ink is also described on the back of the label as to its history, why it was made, what it does, what it symbolizes. It starts out as a replica ink of giant squid, whaleman sepia, which is quite dark. It's one of the darker sepias. And what is unique about it is that with an application of bleach, make a mess here and ruin the replica map. The application of bleach, it gradually transforms from the sepia and turns into the red of the Japanese national flag. After about 4 to 5 minutes, this will completely turn this red color. And after it dries out and ages a ways, or has been rinsed with water to get rid of the remnant bleach, it will age as a type of lavender that is very similar to the lavender chrysanthemums that are found about the emperor's castle. And this symbolizes John Mung and his growth from the 14-year-old boy discovered on Torishima Island and then evolving into someone who knew the outside world, had studied the outside world, its navigation techniques, and gradually became a national figure in Japan, and someone who was consulted by none other than the Emperor Meiji himself for advice about the West and about modernization. And then this transformation of the color from whelmian sepia to the national red of the Japanese flag to the emperor's chrysanthemum. This is as Japanese an ink and as Japanese a story relating to the relations between America and Japan that I could put in a bottle. That is, symbolically, I don't think I could have made a bottle that was more in tune with what the ink was meant to represent than an ink that had an identifier in this order, sepia to red to the emperor's chrysanthemum. That is the history behind this ink. Due to a inability and refusal to barcode this, it's temporarily unavailable in the United States. It is currently available in Taiwan, China, occasionally available in the UK. It's never produced in large quantities. It's a bear to make, and it is likely that it will continue to be made in very small quantities. But I thought it might be of interest to fellow pen collectors as to what was special about it, what it does, and the only way to show this was through video. I hope that information is of assistance. Almost forgot. This is Manjiro Nakahama, filled in a flexible nib creeper. I think this pen is perfect for this particular ink. You want a feed that's got a deep, deep fissure. You don't want something that has a razor-thin fissure or a nib that's set to tolerances where you can't even see a ray of light pass through it. You want something that is more capable of using hundreds of inks, not a pen that only writes with soapy water. And thus, this particular pen, as well as any pen that has a deep fissure and that you can see light through the nib tines, either if you adjust it that way or if you buy it that way, that's the kind of pen that you want with this kind of ink. In fact, that's the kind of pen that can write with a few hundred different inks instead of just a limited few, which means it has utility and isn't restricted to soapy water inks. With very minimal effort, one can get this nib to flex out About 2 millimeters from standard fine. It flexes like a saw blade. You will have some nib creep with this design nib, but that is why it is called the nib creeper. And it writes particularly well with Manjiro Nakahama. So anyone says they have difficulty with such an ink, remember that this particular pen and nib combination costs about the same as a standard ink bottle, and actually costs less than Manjiro Nakahama, which is has more expensive components than the average bottle of Noodler's ink, and thus technically it usually costs a bit more than this pen. But this pen is ideally suited to writing with it. And that's just for your further information.